Let's start with static code analysis. And what that means is we want to scan all of our code for bugs. So what are software vulnerabilities? And why do I care? I'm sure you know a little bit about these, but I want to explain a little more in detail some of the types of vulnerabilities that are available, that are out there, that are threatening software today, and understand, you know, why that's so important we deal with that. And then, of course, we'll talk about the actual static code analysis. What is it? How does it fit into software? And what are some techniques that we use to do that? And of course, after each one of these segments, I talk just a little bit about ROI. Talk about why is important to do it up front, and how does that save you money later? So there's a number of lists of vulnerabilities out there. There's the SANS top 25, there's the OWASP top 10, and there's different vulnerabilities for different languages. Let's take a look at a few. So memory corruption is something that's plagued native code for a long time. Talk about C, C and C++, fully compiled code. They've dealt with this thing called memory corruption for a couple of decades. Buffer overflows, buffer overreads. We'll look at an example of that. That one I don't think was as well understood in the past. And you could audit this code manually. You could look through every loop. You could look at every API. You could look through, you know, each situation. But can you really do that across millions of lines of code? Does that really scale? And so in talking about different types of languages, different architectures, different platforms, there's also script injection, cross-site scripting, cross-site request forgery. Really what that is where we've failed to sanitize code properly. So imagine you go to a web page and you're able to upload something, some name or whatever, and you can also upload script. And that really shouldn't be. That should get sanitized out. The next visitor to the page comes, the script renders in the context of their browser, and lo and behold, their session cookie is sent to a bad actor, and all of a sudden, their bank account is lost. So that sort of vulnerability is more relevant to the web code. And what's interesting is in today's sort of agile DevOps world, we see kind of a blending of these. So imagine something like Office that used to be heavyweight C++ desktop software. Now with Office 360, they have a cloud offering and a web portion of this. So we're seeing some of these vulnerabilities blend across types of software. And again, that's one of these things where being able to automate searching for these kind of vulnerabilities with a tool allows you to scale in a way that you just can't do manually. Other types of vulnerabilities you might be on the lookout for, command injection is a big one that's been around for years. So whether it's a SQL injection or an operating system injection, let me imagine one off the top of my head. Suppose you have some software on an operating system and it's going to list the files in a directory for you. So you supply the directory name. Well, what if you supply some special character like a semicolon, a backtick, an ampersand, something that was unexpected to the programmer? And in fact, the shell might interpret that character in a certain way such that you essentially escape the prior command to just list the files in a directory, and all of a sudden, you can cat the password file or overwrite the password file, something like that. That's a command injection. That's just one of many examples. And I'm not going to take the time to go through every one of these vulnerability types, but you can imagine problems with authentication, problems where we expose data in a way that we shouldn't. Maybe we didn't encrypt it in transit or at rest. Misconfigurations to where our system's not as secure as we thought it might be. So there's all of these different vulnerability types. And let's just talk through a few to get a sense for how critical they are. So here's a typical memory corruption. So we've got a static buffer of a kilobyte, 1024 bytes, and then we copy data in there somehow, a sprintf, a memcopy, a strcpy, whatever it may be, a for loop. And the question is this a vulnerability? And it may not be clear right off the bat. We don't know, for example, just from looking at this snippet of code, how big are these variables name and domain? If the size of these two strings, which are then put together with a format string and then copied into buff, is larger than 1024, we have a stack buffer overflow. And to give you an idea of how severe that is, take a look at this flow. So we've got a function, maybe your main program. It calls this sprintf. And because there's no bounce check on the local variables, we see that it overwrites something important, like a function pointer or the return address in this case, so that when the function tries to return, instead of going back to where it should here, we see that it in fact could go back to attacker shellcode. So that's just to give you an example or kind of whet your appetite for how severe these vulnerabilities can be and how easy in some cases they are for attackers to exploit. Now, of course, there are operating system mitigations and other things nowadays that can help lessen the impact or the severity of vulnerabilities. But, you know, the fact remains that your code has this problem and it needs to be repaired. And it's easy to repair too, by the way. Just change it to an SNPrintf or some other safe version of that copy, and the problem's fixed. The problem is, how do you know where all those vulnerabilities are? And this is another look at like something like a SANS top 25. So there's all these different types of vulnerabilities across all of your code that you've got to go and look for. And that's going to be a very difficult manual process if you don't have a way of automating that. Let me give you one more example before we dive into what static analysis really is and how it can help. This vulnerability is something that's very interesting. It's very near and dear to the heart of Synopsys. It's called the Heartbleed vulnerability, and it was a vulnerability that existed in OpenSSL. There was a feature for a couple years that existed with a vulnerability that was unknown, and it was a feature called the Heartbeat. And what it was is a client could talk to a server who had the vulnerability and say, hey, can you send me the four-letter bird? And the server would say, yep, here's bird. So that's the normal usage of the Heartbeat. The Heartbleed usage is where a malicious actor would say, can you send me the 500-word bird, please? And the server would say, yep, here's the 500-letter word bird. But since you only sent it 4 bytes, it gives you 496 bytes of whatever just happens to be in memory. Could be private keys, could be passwords, could be all kinds of bad things. And what's really interesting and unique about the Heartbleed vulnerability is it was a buffer over read, not a buffer over flow. And those were not thought to be as critical in years gone by. A decade or so ago, if you'd have said, told somebody you were looking for a buffer over read, they would have went, eh, you know, maybe not so impressed with your bug hunting skills. Lo and behold, this bug turns out to be very critical. And that's an interesting thing. We'll talk later about that when we talk about having the discussion of exploitability with developers. Sometimes maybe they don't want to fix or prioritize a bug fix right away because they don't understand or don't believe that it's critical, and they want you to sort of prove that it's exploitable. And sometimes that can be a real rat hole, that discussion. We don't really want to get into that. If we know about a bug, we should fix the bug in as timely a manner as we possibly can. So let's talk a little bit about static analysis. Now that we understand the background about vulnerabilities and why they're so important and why they're out there and what types of vulnerabilities you might see, how do we fit this idea of scanning code automatically into the SDL? Well, it's very simple, and it's one of the most powerful things that we can do because we can integrate this right into the implementation phase. That means that it doesn't have to be something that a highly skilled, you know, highly paid third-party pen tester gets to do at the very end of this project. No, it can be integrated right up front with the developer. They can, in fact, have it integrated with their development tools every time they compile, every time they check in code. This kind of thing can be run right there, and that's the best place to run static analysis. And so before I dig into the techniques that the tool uses under the hood, let me list some of those pros. So the biggest pro is exactly what I was just talking about, the fact that it's integrated with the developer. It's right in that process where you can integrate it with your bug tracking tools, you can have severity ratings, you can have explanations that the developers can understand to help them see how important these vulnerabilities are. The other huge benefit is that it can run across all of your code, so it scales so much better than humans do. Humans can find things that machines can't. We can find those niche little bugs here and there, but I'm not so good at auditing a million lines of code. That's something that a machine's better at doing. And talking about machines, if we find out that the human is better at finding a certain niche bug, we can always build that intelligence into the tool. We can extend it. Are there any drawbacks then? Well, of course, every process, every tool, they all have drawbacks. False positives is definitely a drawback that many of these tools suffer from. That is that they need a little bit of tuning. They need a little bit of help from the human. They may report, especially if you've not done this before and you have a large code base and all of a sudden you just, bam, let's run this across our entire code base. You may get hundreds of alarms or alerts of areas in your code that could have vulnerabilities. And if the developers have to go and check and they find out not all of those are real, they may become a little frustrated with that process. So you have to be a little careful about how you roll this out. Start smart. Start with maybe just new code. Have the developers look at that. Tune down the false positives a little bit at first. And then as you work and the tool is working better and better, then you can tune it up and maybe go back and retroactively scan your legacy code. So using the tools wisely is just as important as what these tools can do for you. Of course, they may miss subtle bugs, and I already talked about that. You know, you may have a situation where the human's better at finding certain niche design things or whatever, and that's something that we could either add into the tool or we can catch with a totally different technique, which we'll talk about. So again, raising the bar of your entire code base is an important thing that static code analysis gives us. Let's look at the whole cycle then. So you establish your goals, and up front you decide, this is the kind of thing I'd like to look for first. For example, if you ask a telco, what's the most critical bug we could find for you? Something that takes the system offline, denial of service, something like that, very critical, the most important thing that they don't want to have their product doing. On the other hand, if you ask a desktop software, a browser, Office, if Word were to crash temporarily, it's not great. You might lose a little data and you might irritate some users, but it's not the end of the world. They're a little more concerned about Office documents carrying viruses and being exploitable and that sort of thing. So understanding what are your goals and your intentions for the review. And then, of course, we want to run those tools. And it's best if we have a fully working environment. You could run this as a pen test at the end against the code base without integrating into the build environment. But that's not the best place to do it. And we've already talked about the fact that the best place is right with the developer, right where the code's compiled. And then we're going to review the findings, and we're going to make fixes, and we're going to continue doing this over and over again. So I'll talk about this. Let's drill into this just a little bit more. So here's your source code. We see that we give it to the machine, basically. It's got pre-installed rules. It's got all this stuff. And we can, again, extend those rules. And then we're going to get raw results out of the analysis tool. And a human needs to be involved in that. Again, whether it's tuning down false positives or maybe extending rules, making sure that what we found really are bugs and we file those bugs so that they get fixed. And again, motivating developers to make those fixes in a timely fashion, that's an important social part of this that we're not going to go into a lot. But generally speaking, we shouldn't find ourselves in the exploitability argument. Hey, this bug's important, this one's not. We just need to make sure that we give a fair rating and say, this bug is pretty severe, it needs to get fixed pretty soon. Or this one's very severe, it needs to get fixed right away. As long as we have rough estimates, I think developers can respond to that. And there are more exact ways with CVSS and other things that we can do to give a better rating numbers. But generally speaking, if we've got bugs and we know about them and they're security critical, we need to make sure they get fixed. All right, so let's move on to some of the exact techniques. And they vary across different languages. If you talk about auditing Java code versus C++ versus C#, there's going to be different techniques and ways that we find bugs. And the cool thing about static analysis tools, the thing I really like about it, is most of that's hidden from the users, the developers, even the security people. They don't always necessarily need to know exactly what algorithm the tool used to find the bugs, as long as it's finding good bugs and reporting them in a way that makes sense. So some of the things we could talk about would be pattern matching, statistical analysis, data flow analysis, and procedural. Those are some, and there's many more techniques that static code analysis tools use. So let's start with pattern matching because it's the easiest one. If we look at a piece of code, and this looks like C code, we see there's a syslog function called from the mylog routine, and it looks like it's missing something. There's this %s, and what is that? That's called the format string. That's something that tells the function how to format the user-supplied data, the message in this case. And if that's missing, there's a vulnerability there. So it's a very simple pattern matching. You either provided the format string or you didn't. And if you didn't, there's a vulnerability. So in many cases, there's been a lot of academic research around static code analysis, and there's some very complex techniques to, as far as following data and finding vulnerabilities, all good stuff. But in many cases, a lot of the low-hanging fruit, again, raising the bar of your whole code base, it doesn't necessarily take super complex analysis. It just needs to be automated and done in a way that's repeatable, in a way that we can fix to create safer code. So let's look at some others. Statistical analysis, for example. What that is imagine you have a piece of code. You copy it, you paste it, and you tweak a few variables. That's a very common thing that developers do all the time. Now, in this case, we can see that there's this value returns that they had in the original. And in the pasted version of that, they changed most of the portions of that to be another variable named locals, except they forgot at the very end to change it to returns. And that's something that we could pick up with statistical analysis. Data flow analysis is probably one of the best techniques for finding security critical bugs statically. And let me show you an example of how that works. So we have this idea of a source and a sink. Basically, what that means is where data comes in and where it gets used or copied or ultimately goes out. And typically, we're following untrusted data, not just static data that lives in a global table or something, but data that can come from a network packet, from a file, something that an attacker might have rights to supply. So if you look at this snippet of code, we can see that we're allocating with malloc some memory, and we're allocating 4 times dword size. And so 4 times 4 is 16, and then looks like we're doing a copy loop with memcopy, and the source of the data comes from argv, which in this case represents untrusted data, some command line input, and that gets copied to this buf7, which is the pointer to the allocated memory. So we're copying, looks like, 4 loops of 4 bytes apiece, so it looks like we have enough memory. That looks good. To the human auditor, they may think, say, hey, this code looks fine, and especially if you're auditing hundreds of thousands of lines of code, it's just tough to try to drill into these. But data flow analysis with a static analysis tool should be able to fairly easily identify the fact that actually we had 4 times 2 plus 2. So it wasn't in fact 16 bytes allocated, it was only 10. And so you're gonna have a memory corruption bug right in the area of this memcopy loop. And that's something that we could point out with data flow analysis. Let's talk about another technique called procedural. Intra and inter procedural, where we use solvers to find new paths through data and examine the use of objects or elements within those paths. So for example, here we have an object X. We check to see if it's null, and if it's not, then we can use it. Where later on, we use that same method, but we forget to check that it's null, or we do it later, and that's a mismatch that we're able to find with that type of technique. So what's really cool is a lot of these static analysis tools, so you don't have to understand all of those different techniques, sort of the under the hood stuff. You can typically go out and find a data sheet that says, you know, here's all the different types of things we check for and bugs we can find in these different languages. So that gives you an idea of the heavy lifting that these tools can do for you. One of the other things I want to point out is it's not all about pure bugs. It's not just how many, you know, this tool finds 95% of bugs and this tool finds 93% of bugs. It's nice to know, but the one that can be integrated more fully, the one that's more useful, the one that helps developers understand what those bugs really are so that repairs can be properly made, that's the tool that's more useful. So think about grouping and sorting results. Can the tool do that? Can it eliminate unwanted results? In other words, can you tune down those false positives? Does it explain the significance of a finding? So here's the technique we used, this is the bug, and that's what this bug is, and here's some data about that. That type of stuff is very important to helping developers understand the importance and making the fix in a timely fashion. So let me summarize this static code analysis section. We want to find bugs sooner, especially compared to fielded crashes or real failures in the field. There's no comparison. The money you save, the reputation that you save, it's very huge return on investment, basically. You don't have to go and explain to your customers why this bad thing happened. And so the other thing to summarize about the static code analysis, again, it's something that we can integrate further to the left. In SDL speak, that means we looked at that original SDL picture. The further to the left we can integrate that, the earlier we're able to make those fixes, and it, again, decrease the cost of repairs and increase your reputation and your investment that the customers make when they buy your software. It could be a real market differentiator. If they find out that your software isn't as secure as your competitors, they might not buy your stuff anymore. So I think the ROI is pretty easy to measure for most of these.